So we start the program today, and the first talk was given by Xiao Kang about the symmetry protected topological and the group and group coherence theory. So let's welcome the speaker.
So yesterday I went through about 29 slides. I have 90 slides. So, but yesterday I only been able to kind of give a brief review of topological order and give some kind of classification of so-called invertible topological order, basically topological order with no excitation. But this classification of invertible topological order, I use this to serve two purposes. One is later we are going to use it to understand SPD order. And however, I also want to use this example to demonstrate the way of thinking that we are going to use to understand SPD order. Basically, this concept of the topological partition function, which is a topological invariance used by mathematician to classify a topological manifold. And it turns out this topological invariance, topological partition function can be written down as using the characteristic class. So the mathematician has studied this kind of topological invariance. And yesterday there was a point, but I think it's looking for that. So we can using topological invariance constructed by mathematicians. For example, here is one of the examples of topological invariance. The topological partition function is written as an integration of some kind of a Stieber-Whitney class. And then using this kind of knowledge, we can find in each dimension what kind of invertible topological order can we have. So then we build a table. So that's kind of an idea. And so today we are going to try to study more general topological phase. But however, to go beyond the invertible topological order is rather difficult. And so next step, certainly, we will study topological order which have a non-trivial quasi particle, and this is rather difficult. And we kind of know the mathematics needed, something like a tensor category theory would need it. And however, there is another way to find another kind of a simple problem, which is we can add a symmetry. When we add a symmetry to the Hamiltonian, then there's a new situation, and when there's a new situation, there's a simple, among new situation, there's a simple problem, and then we can make a progress. So here we consider a gapped system with symmetry. Basically, we have some kind of a Hamiltonian which satisfies certain symmetry, and certainly when the Hamiltonian have a symmetry, it have many ground states. Certainly those ground states, some of them have a Langmuir entanglement, so we say there's many different phases. And then some of them have a shorter entanglement. But however, here we only consider ground states which do not break symmetry. We are not talking about a symmetry breaking states. So it's apparently if you do not break symmetry and there's a shorter entanglement, looks like it's pretty trivial, only one phase. But actually, there's a surprise here that we have many different phases. Even for shorter entanglement, even we do not break symmetry, there's still many different phases. The reason is falling. You know, when you have a shorter entangled states, That means these two sharply entangled states can be connected by this local unitary transformation. But however, this local unitary transformation is like a time evolution. But this time evolution, this local unitary transformation, may not preserve the symmetry. That is the unitary operator we used to connect these two sharply entangled states do not preserve this kind of symmetry. But however, when Hamiltonian have a symmetry, when you try to deform one state to another state, the deformation path should be all symmetric, should preserve the symmetry. We should not break symmetry and deform states. So then we ask, can we find a local unitary transformation which preserves the symmetry, which is an environment under this kind of symmetry transformation that connect two shortly entangled states? Then the answer is not always. So sometimes we can have a shortly entangled states which can be connected by definition a local unitary transformation that do not preserve symmetry, but cannot be connected by local unitary transformation that preserves symmetry. So then we have this situation. Even without symmetry breaking, we have shortly entangled states, but they still belong to different phase. And the shortly entangled states is very simple. Okay. So but actually this kind of states is pretty well known. Turns out the first example is a one-dimensional Hodan phase. So you heard about that yesterday. This AKLT state is a one-dimensional Hodan phase. And for fermion system, there's a more well-known example that is a two-dimensional, three-dimensional topological insulator. And they all have this, they all belong to this so-called shortly entangled symmetric states. Okay. So as Zheng Chen emphasized yesterday, these shortly entangled states really have this property that with the symmetry, they can belong to different phase. If you break the symmetry, then all these phase can connect continuously deform into each other. Actually, they can all be continuously deformed to the trivial product states. And this is our opportunity, because you can see, without symmetry, we have a longer entangled state. Those states are very difficult. With the symmetry, you have even more kind of a longer entangled states. And those are even more difficult. However, with the symmetry, even short range entangled states can belong to different phase. And those should be easy. So that's our way to isolate easier problem. And so maybe we can understand those states in a very systematic way. And indeed, so we find that this kind of shortly entangled states have this quite a systematic construction. But however, the mathematics behind this construction is this so-called a group cohomology. So group cohomology is a symbol H, and that is just a set. But however, it's not only a set; it's actually an abelian group. So this symbol is abelian group. Basically, given the symmetry group, then we can, given dimension, somehow mathematics tell you, you can construct abelian group. And then what we find is that for each element of this abelian group, we can construct an SPD phase. We can construct one of the SPD phase. So therefore, once we know, if you know this group homology, then we have a way to construct many different kinds of SPD states. So this really led to the so-called group cohomology theory for the SPD phase. And so in this lecture, I will try to, maybe in this lecture, if I couldn't finish, so we have this extra lecture at the end of the day, we will try to maybe explain this group cohomology theory of SPD phase. Okay. So it's very much like what Zheng Chen talked about yesterday. You know, in the Zheng Chen's talk, he talked about he can start with a superfluid phase, which have a U1 symmetry, but the ground state spontaneously break U1 symmetry. Then he can disorder the superfluid other parameter to get a symmetric phase, which do not break U1 symmetry. And here we kind of doing the same thing. To understand the SPD phase, we start with a nonlinear sigma model. We start with nonlinear sigma model. And this nonlinear sigma model, if have many phases, the one of phase is this the field, this G is a field in the nonlinear sigma model. This field in the semi-classical limit have a very small fluctuation. So basically the ground state is just this field equal to constant. And this corresponds to this superfluid phase or symmetry breaking phase. Okay. And then what we do is that then we starting with this symmetry breaking phase, then we slowly increase the quantum fluctuation. When the quantum fluctuation became strong enough, the symmetry will be restored. Then we get a symmetric phase. And then we try to study, do we get a unique symmetric phase, or we can have a different way to get a different symmetric phase. And this different symmetric phase may correspond to different SPD states. So that's basically the idea. And but here, because we want to study symmetry breaking in the most general sense, so we start with a nonlinear sigma model which break all the symmetry. So such nonlinear sigma model, the field in the nonlinear sigma model actually take its value in the group itself. So we have nonlinear sigma model, the targeted space is the symmetry group itself. And when this field equal to constant, you break all the symmetry. Okay. And since this field is a group element, so the symmetry action, there's several different symmetry action. And here we just make a choice that the symmetry action is just the action, say, from the left. We just multiply this field by another constant group element, and this is a symmetry transformation. And clearly, this kind of action is invariant under this kind of symmetry transformation. So this the action is have a symmetry. But whether ground state have a symmetry or not depend on the action. In particular, depend on this parameter lambda, which is called the coupling constant. If a coupling constant is very small, then you can see that the derivative of the field is suppressed. So the field won't be constant. So therefore, if a lambda is very small, this coefficient very large, the field is almost constant, then the ground state is kind of ordered. So the field is more or less equal to a constant. But however, if lambda is very large, then if lambda is very large, then the fluctuation of G getting stronger. So the G is not no longer constant, and it can fluctuate very strongly and freely. Then this then we have a quantum disordered phase, where this field averages field equal to zero, the other parameter equal to zero, so the symmetry is restored. Okay, and so this will be the so when lambda is large, we have this disordered phase. And then we can use the renormalization group picture to try to understand this phenomenon. When lambda is small, actually, the RG flow of lambda will make lambda even smaller. So eventually, the fixed point, RG fixed point for small lambda phase is lambda equal to zero. So in that case, the G is really constant. When lambda is large, the RG flow of lambda is different. But lambda will become even larger when you go to low energy. So at the low energy, lambda flow to infinity. So the key point is that the RG fixed point for lambda going to infinity simply is action equal to zero. Or for each pass, the action amplitude for the pass, we do pass integral, for each pass, the action amplitude equal to one. So that's trivial. That's a trivial phase. And this is expected. And so this and this is the character of a topological phase. You know, topological phase means we have nothing at the low energy because we have energy gap. Below energy gap, we have nothing, really, really nothing. when you have a nothing, then what action describe a nothing? Then action equal to zero describe a nothing. So that's it. So that's why topological order are simple, because topological order is nothing. Then if a nothing have a little bit of something, then the something is pretty simple. And so here again because this in the disordered phase they have energy gap, all the correlation functions are short range. So really at long distance should be trivial. There's no long distance behavior. Everything's trivial. So we have this fixed point theory for topological order is just action equal zero. Okay. And that's really the character of a topological order. And so any question here?
Yeah.
So this is basically the general picture. So now let's try to say that actually the nothing here is there is a something in the nothing. And so actually the non-nothing model we described is the simplest one. Actually, there is a way to make this a little more complicated, and basically it's by adding this topological term. So what kind of topological term can we add? Well, we can add this so-called 2-pi quantized topological term. This kind of topological term is usually called a theta term. But here, I choose theta to be multiple of 2-pi. So this is a 2-pi quantized theta term, we can also call that. So this kind of topological term coming from the fact that this topological term can appear if this pi d plus 1 of a group element, a group is not equal to 0. So remember d plus 1 is a dimension of space-time. If a pi d plus 1 of a symmetric group is not 0, that means we can have a non-trivial map, which map this, so let's assume space-time is S d plus 1, is a sphere. Then we can have a map into the targeted space. The targeted space happens to be the group. And then we ask whether all this kind of map can be shrinked into, can be deformed into constant map. You know, trivial map is that we map all the sphere into a single point of a G, and that is trivial map. And but there are many so-called non-trivial map. But the many non-trivial map can be continuously deformed into constant map or trivial map. But somehow sometimes there are some map which cannot be deformed into trivial map. And so those called topologically non-trivial map. And this topological non-trivial map would belong to the non-trivial element in this, this also abelian group, this pi t. So this is what we call the Wanning number. A simplest example of this map would be the in 0 plus 1 dimension. So when in 0 plus 1 dimension we have map from S to the group. So that's which is equal to U1, let's assume symmetry group is U1. And this also S1. So therefore, in this case, the non-trivial map is kind of a familiar Wanning number. So in this 0 plus 1 dimension, and for the symmetry group equal to S1, we can actually write down this topological term actually is given by this G inverse partial T G. And this is a topological term, and we can have a k in front. And okay, and then we can certainly parameterize this group using a theta group element theta e to the I theta is a group element of U1. Then if you parameterize this way, then this topological term is very simple. It's a k times theta dot over 2 pi, and the k is an integer. Okay, and for this kind of topological term, we can just plug into here. We can show that the integration of a topological term without this 2 pi the integration, I write anything here. Yeah, the integration of a topological term is always equal to the integer, yeah, here. It's an integer, is k times an integer. This integer is a one in number. So therefore, this topological term has a special property that its integration over the space-time is always equal to integer. And because we have 2 pi I here, integer times 2 pi I, so the actual amplitude is not modified. And so if an action have this actual 2 pi I phase, then the this action amplitude is still equal to 1. Okay. So this kind of interesting thing is that this 2 pi topological term have this property that it's changed the action in some way. But action amplitude do not have any change. So for every pass in space-time, with or without this topological term, every pass still have amplitude equal to 1. So it's not modified by this topological term. Okay. And so this is the example for 0 plus 1 dimension with the symmetry group U1. We can have another example in the 2 plus 1 dimension where symmetry group is SU2. In this case, you know, SU2 group manifold have a topology of a three-dimensional sphere. Okay. And in this case, the topological term is a little more complicated. So here the G is a 2x2 matrix. We can use a 2x2 matrix, unitary matrix to parameterize this SU2 group. Using this 2x2 unitary matrix, we can construct this element, this kind of object, which I forgot to take a trace. There's a trace of this. Yeah, I forgot to have a trace here. And then this kind of, so this will be the topological term for this 2 plus 1 dimension SU2 symmetry. Again, this particular construction, we can show that the integration of this this up W, again equal to integer, always equal to integer. So it's again have this property that the for with topological term, the fixed point theory, remember the fixed point theory for large lambda phase is that the lambda go to infinity, so this term is gone. So therefore, fixed point action is just purely topological term. And then when one have purely topological term, the action amplitude always equal to 1. So the same thing as before. And actually, we know this a long, long time ago. You know, not like 2011, but actually it's 1980s. We know this. This is well known. But unfortunately, at that time, we think because this action amplitude is not modified by this topological term, we say these two theories are equivalent. They are the same thing. So actually, we view this this kind of topological term as a gauge choice. Basically, we say sometimes two different actions may describe exactly the same theory. And that's how we view this topological term. That is, we say the action with or without topological term, they describe equivalent theory. It's just a many-to-one description of physics. You know, action is a mathematical description of physical system. Here we just claim that this description is pretty bad. It's not a one-to-one description, it's a many-to-one description. Sometimes we have a different action describe the same physics. And this is also well known because it's called the function called duality. Duality means you have a different action describe exactly the same physical term. And so here we thought this adding this topological term is kind of like duality. Different action describe the same physical system. And now we know this is incorrect. So this is kind of thinking back is amazing. So 20, 30 years ago, we already know this. But at that time, we just don't have a courage or don't have an insight to realize a different 2 pi quantized topological term actually describe different system. You know, we didn't realize that. But actually, we should realize that because of the, you know, Wu Daqi in Hong Kong, also in, I think in the 90s, he wrote a paper to say that, yes, even 2 pi quantized topological term for the Hodan phase actually corresponds to different Hodan phase. At that time, he already realized this. And so again, you know, that's again another missed opportunity. If one combine that knowledge with this knowledge, one should develop SPD theory in 90s, not in 2000s. You know, that's so all the ingredients are there. Just somehow, I don't know, the connection is not made at that time. But here, the main point is that here we claim that actually the different two-pi quantized Tableau term, actually they do not describe same physical states, actually describe different physical states. And these different physical states happen to be these SPT states.
So
yes?
When you say the Tableau algorithm has no dynamical effect, do you also mean that the RG flow or they will not be changed or there will be no new physical in the world?
It's a very interesting question because okay, yeah. So because this winding number is quantized as an integer, so therefore the coefficient is not quantized. We don't have to quantize the coefficient. So therefore actually this coefficient don't have to be 2 pi, can be any number theta. Okay. And this is a very, very interesting and important question. And actually Chen Ke studied this. That's the theta also have RG flow. And naturally it flow to zero. You know, theta flow zero will have no effect, so that's natural. But you can see that when theta to 2 pi, this topology also have no effect. So if theta to zero is RG fixed point, theta to 2 pi is also RG fixed point. So therefore, so from here you can see that if using RG flow, the theta can flow to zero or 2 pi or 4 pi, etc. Previously we think the theta is a periodic. Basically you say fixed point, theta to zero fixed point and theta to 2 pi fixed point are the same, fixed point. And now we see they are different. They are different fixed point. And actually though, maybe just make a remark. They are different fixed point because the boundary theory is different because this term became the so-called Wessimino term for the boundary theory. You know, it's really pity we know all this back in 90s, and somehow the even though this Wessimino term interpretation that's really Da Qi's work, and but somehow this just one more step, this generalization is not being made. Yeah. And so therefore this 2 pi quantized topology, this 2 pi quantization have a dynamical meaning. Have dynamic stability. But then we ask, how do you know they flow to zero? I don't know. It's a guess. And I just say, maybe let me just say what the intuition guess. You know, when theta equal to zero, that means all the paths have an actual amplitude equal to one. And that means when you do path integral, all the paths have a constructive interference. So this is a sweet spot. You know, that's where the system want to be. You know, when all the interference are constructive, the path integral will have a large weight, and that's where the system want to flow to. So the RG flow is basically try to search for the, you know, stationary path basically is a neighborhood where we have a constructive interference. So therefore, when theta to zero, all the paths have a same phase. They have constructive interference, and that is like a stationary path, like a sweet spot. When theta not equal to zero or 2 pi, then different paths may have different phase. You have a destructive interference. And then that's usually things become complicated and sometimes it's gapless. Basically, if theta equal to 2 pi, the theta do not know whether it follows to zero or 2 pi. And when it's not to pi, usually that's representing a gapless phase. And this intuition of a constructing the interference of all different paths in path integral suggests that theta to zero or theta to 2 pi is an RG fixed point. And so things will flow to that point. So that's kind of a picture for this nonlinear thing model. Okay. So that's what I just said. The fixed point theory is given by the pure topological term, and the different pure topological term may correspond to a different symmetric phase, and that may be the SPD phase. Okay, so that's basically the statement.